controlling our kids. We know it certainly becomes harder as they get older. So it raises the question, how much control is too much?
Joining us now is Dr. Laura Saunders. She's a psychologist at the Institute of Living with Hartford HealthCare. You know, Karen and I were reading some of this. I was reading some of this, Doc.
This is a big one.
Psychological control. It doesn't sound too good to me.
Hello, friends, and happy Wednesday.
Happy Wednesday.
So, yes, and I'll tell you a little bit of the origin of where this topic came from. So my daughter has her license, and I saw her drive off without me in the car, and I said to myself, I have no control.
Right.
You've lost it. You've just lost it with her driving.
And we might have lost Dr. Saunders for a second, too, because she's frozen, but let's just give it a second, see if the Wi-Fi comes back.
Oh, I don't like, well, she looks good when she's frozen, though.
Yeah. You're not frozen anymore.
Control and behavioral control.
Wait, so back up a little bit because we lost you for a second. You have two kinds of control.
Psychological control and behavioral control. So psychological control is folks like this in the work that I do, parents who've tried to control their thoughts, behaviors, opinions, ideas, and feelings. It's more sort of what we would think of like cult-like, but it happens a lot more than you would think. That's different than behavioral control. Behavioral control is setting limits, having boundaries. You know, these are the expectations for you. You have a curfew. So doing things like that, that's behavioral control. We need that. But it's also really, really important to have dialogue, right? There's a reason that your curfew is 11 o'clock, and that's because the restricted driving laws say that's when you need to be home with your car, right? So explaining things and having that dialogue is important. Gone are the days where do as I say and don't ask any questions, because kids just rebel against that. So I'm the adult, these are my limits, but this is why.
So there's a little bit of a difference, you say, that we need to be thinking of restraint versus command. And I think it's also, we grew up with because I said so, and that was the way it was, and it just doesn't work anymore.
Well, but if you think about it, and we don't need to get into too many personal stories here, but we all rebelled against that, right? Especially teenagers, and I'm really focused more on teenagers. With younger kids, you can be a lot more directive, but when you get to teenagers, you say, I'll show you, and I'll do, you know. So, and I'm not saying we don't set limits as parents. We absolutely 100% need to set limits. But we know that kids are experiential learners, right? We can tell them not to touch the stove, but the reality is they will learn not to touch the stove because they put their hand close to it and it was very hot, or maybe they even burned their finger.
Right.
So within limits, they need to have experiences. That's the way they learn best.
And you say start early. How early?
Well, I think no matter, you know, if the limit is for your 10-year-old, you need to be in bed by 8 o'clock. Well, the reason is because you get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and you need 10 hours of sleep, right? So it's just providing information. It's not over-explaining oneself, but providing information. The reason that we're doing it this way is because of this reason. So giving information, it actually helps create logic, right? This is the reason why we do something. This is the limit, and this is the reason why. So we're trying to create logic for so many of these kids that are so engrossed in other, you know, forms of interacting. When you're talking with your kids and you're sitting at dinner, this is the reason why we do this in our family. So not being so controlling, and the reality is, we actually have control over very little, but we want to set the limits and parameters for success.
So you say it's also an important skill, and maybe this will let parents, I think sometimes we're controlling because we're fearful that something bad's going to happen.
Right.
So we're trying to protect them, and I don't know if it's worse now than it was when we were growing up, or we're just more aware of it, but you say they need to learn self-efficacy, and they only learn that by making their own decisions.
Right. There has to be some amount of, whether for younger kids, whether you wear green pants or blue pants really should be your decision. Right. Now, I think as a parent, you'd like the pants and top to match, but really, who's the one that needs to go through that? So as your kids get older, they need to see that they have a sense of, when I make this decision, this is what happens. That's a sense of self-efficacy. I understand that the more I can make decisions and understand the consequences, the more my learning happens. And again, that's the experiential learner. These kids do not learn by just do as I say. They have to do it. So if they're going to do it, let's have them understand why and do it within limits, because releasing all control is very scary.
It really is. All right. Well, thank you, Dr. Saunders. We appreciate your time. Happy Wednesday.
Happy Wednesday. I look forward to seeing you next week.
All right. Take care.
Deep breath for all the parents of teens out there, for sure.